Welcome back to Today in Rocket Science. I'm Adam Balkin. It is the granddaddy of all science fairs. The Intel International Science and Engineering Fair brings 1,700 of the best and brightest from around the world to showcase their work. Tyrolyn Wagner takes us inside the fair to check out this year's top projects.
They're conducting cutting-edge research.
I created a flexible photovoltaic dress, or basically in simple terms, a flexible solar cell dress.
In the rapidly emerging field of soft robotics, I helped solve the problem of unpredictable motion by designing a soft robotic gripper to inflate predictably.
Working on everything from solar clothes to advanced robotics, 1,700 students came together to showcase their research at the 2015 Intel International Science and Engineering Fair in Pittsburgh. With 20 different categories and over $4 million in prizes, it's the largest science fair in the world, the culmination of a circuit of worldwide science and engineering fairs. This year's top prize of $75,000 went to Raymond Wang from British Columbia for his research on improving aircraft cabin airflow to prevent the spread of disease.
Using these insights that I gained, I'm actually able to engineer modifications that you can implement overnight inside an aircraft cabin to reduce disease transmission by up to 55 times and improve fresh air inhalation by up to 190%.
Organizers say one of the main goals is to put these teens in the spotlight, encourage them to continue pursuing STEM careers.
Our goal really here, ultimately, is to make these students feel like and realize that we value the work that they put in and the possibility of them becoming scientists and engineers at this level.
But for the students, it's also an opportunity to share their research with their peers.
And it's just amazing to see what other people at the same age as me can do in terms of really pushing the edge of science.
I think that the most critical portion of any science convention, whether it's in high school, in college, or in rural university, is that it brings together many bright minds, and it's a platform for the exchange of many ideas.
And who knows, maybe one day these teens will team up to create STEM solutions to tomorrow's problems. For It Ain't Rocket Science, I'm Tyrolyn Wagner.
Now, it may not be quite as grand as Intel ICEF, but students in New York City are touting some serious STEM skills in their own meeting of the minds. In this one, creating the coolest code is key to raking in the big bucks.
Learning to code is like getting superpowers.
These students have been hard at work for months designing and programming projects for the second annual Dream It, Code It, Win It competition. They're all finalists in the contest that aims to celebrate and reward creativity in computer science.
Parasim is a way for you to visualize your parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous systems in virtual reality.
We made a web application to facilitate parent-teacher conferences because they're really hectic at Stuyvesant.
Over $60,000 in cash and prizes were awarded at the event held at the Cooper Union and organized by Trading Screen, Inc. and the MIT Enterprise Forum of New York. But for these young programmers, it's about much more than the awards.
When you tell people that you want to be a computer scientist and software engineer, they're like, what? You know, they kind of step back for a second. But to think about it, I'm actually pretty proud of myself.
In today's connected world, sparking an interest in science and technology comes in many shapes and sizes. But for one generation, there's one man who became synonymous with STEM with his morning science show on PBS. Shazia Khan gets one-on-one with Bill Nye, the Science Guy.
Well, I'm trying to change the world by getting a next generation of kids to be scientifically literate. That's just me.
Bill Nye is well known for his educational television program, which ran for 5 years in the 90s and gained him wide recognition as the Science Guy. Since then, he's been active as one of the country's leading science educators and advocates. We caught up with him at the launch of a new after-school program called Sylvan Edge, a series of workshops and activities all designed around the sciences.
It's the same company that's very well known for tutoring. Now has these things in science, technology, engineering, and math. Kids learn to write a little computer code. Kids build robots with Legos mostly. And they do math quizzes and math games. And I gotta say, I was skeptical, but the kids have a great time.
I've always just had that interest in robots, and on the chemical side, I've always wanted to do biological robots, so program cells and all that kind of stuff.
You literally control the lives of these robots. You can create anything.
Even though it may just seem like fun and games to the students here, getting the next generation into the STEM fields is actually some pretty serious stuff.
It is analogous to what people call the Sputnik moment, when Sputnik flew and people in the United States realized that the United States had to get technically savvy to keep up economically. And the same is true today, maybe more so. In order to compete on the world stage, to get the U.S. economy moving, innovating, you need scientists and engineers. Innovation is what keeps the U.S. in the game. And for those ideas, you need scientifically literate students.
Students who can lead the charge on the world's next Sputnik moment. For It Ain't Rocket Science, I'm Shazia Khan.
The future of STEM runs the gamut, from robots to rockets to computer science. But there's more than meets the eye when it comes to the next evolution in technology. In the nation's largest city, students are getting a glimpse into the tiny, nearly invisible world of nanotech.
Everything from learning about nanomaterials, nanoproducts, just about the scale of nanotechnology.
It's part of Nano Days, an annual national event that aims to get kids across the country in contact with nanotechnology.
These are made with very tightly woven materials, nanomaterials.
I learned that nano is like a very small thing and it's being applied to everyday items like the clothing that I just saw. I can make it like waterproof.
From waterproof fabrics to how thermal conductivity and heat transfer affect objects on a nano scale, the showcase captured the attention of the younger audience.
I expected to warmer surface to melt the ice quicker, but the cooler surface, the ice melted really fast. The heat is being conducted away from your hand, so it feels cooler.
The idea is to get kids generally excited about science, technology, engineering, mathematics, because I believe there's not enough engineers out there.
It's really cool because I never knew that this was possible before, and it really shows me how much the technology that we have is developing.
All right, we do have to stop here for one more quick break. Then, coming up,
we're taking a look at how science and art cross paths. We'll take a look at how students in North Carolina are putting an all-new meaning to Coast Guard as they put their creative skills to the test to protect local wetlands. And we'll see what it takes to put on a Broadway production as we go backstage in the Land of Oz. Find more hands-on science, technology, engineering, and math opportunities in your community. Check out theconnectory.org, where curiosity meets opportunity.